first, before I start, I want to say that you're going to hear some familiar concepts because I'm also taking a historical perspective as Dr. Francesca Iurlaro. But although part of her research, like for example, Fuller traces back to the legacy of Maine, this predates it, so it has a little bit of a different content. So I would like you to approach it with a bit of a more open mind. So I'm going to give myself exactly 15 minutes. I'm going to be reading parts of it because I practice to make sure I will stay within 15 minutes. But Professor Westerman will interrupt me if I go further. Okay, so it is my thesis that Henry Maine's legacy conceals a valuable philosophical perspective. And in this presentation, I would like to highlight three contributions this legacy can have for the philosophy of customary international law. I shall argue that the parallelization of this perspective can dispel the ontological critiques and concerns that stem from the realm of domestic legal systems and general jurisprudence, provide a useful narrative and conceptual tools by which to understand the development and evolution of customary international law as an effective normative system of legal nature, and challenge the formalism which domestic legal systems and general jurisprudence have set as the ideal for all law. Now, by formalism, I understand the theory which treats formal documents as better instruments for the preservation or publicization of existing legal rules and the creation of new legal rules. In other words, the trend to codify rules of customary international law and the trend of replacing informal customary rule formation with formal treaty making. Now, as early as 1861, Maine had a disagreement with the philosophies of law of his time. His main thesis was that law is not merely a philosophical concept of reflection, but a social phenomenon with intersubjective empirical dimensions. These dimensions should both guide and limit philosophizing. As such, to the extent that philosophies of law are ahistorical, and as such unable to accommodate how law historically manifested, evolved, and developed, they must be rejected. Maine's legal history, then, comes to scrutinize the idea that all law originates in the formal acts of a sovereign and lays out foundation for a more enlightened philosophical scheme. So let's explore a bit Maine's narrative and see how it can benefit the philosophy of customary international law. Now, Maine's Ancient Law is a book of many hidden gems and insights, but I shall limit myself to discussing two general themes. First, law is not a static, externally imposed system of commands and threats, nor is law a new or recent phenomenon. Like living, breathing organisms, law itself has a history and a line of development. History speaks of law as an evolutionary phenomenon. Law exists and has existed in a myriad of forms long before the arrival of any sovereign or the concept of legislation. Rather than being unconnected to custom, law begins with custom, and it is questionable whether it ever grows beyond it. The simplest truisms lie in the fact that A, formal law was itself based upon pre-existing customs, which were accounted for as existing independently of the authority which came to ascertain them, while B, domestic legal systems evolved into the formalized structures we experience today out of informal yet quite complex customary regimes. Now, before the constitution of nation states and sovereign kings, there was both social and legal organization. Individuals were not dispersed, nor in a war with each other. Rather, individuals were organized in institutions, the primary of which was the family. Now, within each family institution, law was the word of the father, but this was not yet on the same level as true law, which was the level of customary law. Customary law is then law properly so, as well as the most primary and fundamental manifestation, since that is the normative system which organizes individuals in the institutions through which society understands them by. Further, it is customary law that which designates the word of the father as authoritative within each, especially since in other societies, customary law designates the word of the mother. Now, this, of course, has its own conceptual connection to customary international law and how it establishes an international society out of state institutions within which the word of the sovereign king is law. From this perspective, sovereignty itself is a construction of law. This idea was theorized as early as 1888, where Maine writes, "What really enables states to exercise their sovereignty in this way is nothing but the legal rule itself. And this legal rule can be none other than the rule of customary international law." Interestingly, in the same way ancient law begins by dealing primarily with family institutions to recognizing and dealing with individuals, so does customary international law. In this way, law is a phenomenon that initially grows customarily from the inside out and evolves alongside the society it stems out of. The changing structures of law reflect the changing structures of society, and legality is the most integral mode in the operation of custom. It seems then that the ontological critiques and concerns of general jurisprudence stem from a historically incorrect understanding of how domestic legal systems themselves evolved. In this way, Maine's philosophical perspective can serve as a common framework by which both customary international law and domestic legal systems can be conceptualized as central instances of legal phenomena at different levels of their development. Further, rather than trapping customary international law in between the two extremes of mere customary law and formalized domestic legal systems, Maine's evolutionary narrative allows us to see many stages in between the two and seeks to reveal some of the adverse effects that followed the formalized path chosen by domestic legal systems. Now, the idea is that once writing was invented, societies believed formal documents, or stone monuments at the time, to provide better means for the preservation and publicization of law. While such formalization was necessitated by the particular circumstances of domestic legal systems, it had its own adverse effects. The formalization of law, to the extent that it detached rules from the development of the practices that underpin them, and prevented custom from yielding new legal rules or taking away validity from outdated ones, halted the spontaneous development of law and caused formal law to fall out of date with society. From there, Maine separates two kinds of societies: the static ones, which perished because their law could no longer support the developing society it stemmed out of, and the progressive ones, those which did manage to find ways to update their law to keep it in line with new social needs. By investigating the progressive societies, Maine conceptualized three agencies by which law was changed and adapted to its environment: legal fictions, equity, and legislation. The different agencies also represent different levels in the evolution of law. While legislation is unquestionably absent in international law, the other two agencies allow us to both exhibit and comprehend the current level and structure of development of customary international law, as well as certain of the processes it silently employs. Now, the first, legal fictions are processes employed primarily, although not exclusively, by courts and tribunals. Maine noticed that while ancient law knows nothing of legislators, it knows heavily the presence of courts. These courts, though, only claim to ascertain, interpret, and apply already established customary law, and never claimed authorship, nor coercive enforcement for themselves. Under the surface, and implicitly though, courts did much more than that, because in the process of ascertaining, interpreting, and applying law, courts, as well as other agents, ended up inevitably furthering, evolving, and even changing law. The fiction then refers to the idea that even after the interpretation and application and extension of a legal rule to a new case, the legal rule remains the same. The reality is that its content and function have changed, even if formally the rule remains the same. Now, taking this to customary international law, this process might no longer be a fiction. As Baker notes, new law often arises not from lawmaking bodies, but rather from citations of practice, where often general and ambiguous rules and statutes are interpreted and put into action. Of course, someone trained in the realm of domestic legal systems and general jurisprudence might feel uncomfortable with this thought. According to the traditional positivist picture of the rule of law, law should always be publicly made in advance by conscious, deliberate, formal acts, and courts should only limit themselves to strictly applying it. Maine's legacy, though, tells us that for the biggest part of history, law grows in practice rather than in the formal acts. Courts both give expression to the changes that have already happened informally in practice and guide the evolution of legal practices through their own articulations. While this process might cause its own set of problems, which in turn call for better regulation, Maine's perspective teaches us that the existence of this problem, of this process, is not a problem. Rather, it is the normal way by which customary law, unrestrained by formalities, adapts to its environment and manages to come to terms with an evolving society and a continuously changing environment. Yeah. Now, equity refers to bodies of rules founded and justified upon distinct, usually moral principles, which, while not already established as customary law, supersede established customary law and gain legality or an ever-increasing legal relevance due to the high normativity which their content exerts upon a society. Taking this to the field of customary international law, we see such bodies of rules all around us, and Maine perspective allows us to both comprehend them and dispel some of the perplexities that surround them. Human rights are a good example of this. Now, human rights have traditionally been a body of rules which exists next to settled customary international law. However, due to the high and increasingly pressing opinio iuris this body of rules has received, due to the normativity generated by its moral content, certain efforts have been made to concretize human rights by fitting them under customary international law. No matter how one looks at it, though, grounding human rights within customary international law cannot be the declaration nor the interpretation of existing law. On the contrary, this process is one of change, one through which new rules of customary international law arise. As Baker notes, this new scholarship argues that international treaties, especially those encompassing human rights obligations, actually generate international legal norms. It presents a framework which insists that the signing of a convention or treaty by a wide group of countries is in and of itself evidence of the creation of new customary legal norms. However, by failing to realize how human rights receive special treatment and get grounded in a different way than normal rules of customary international law, we risk collapsing and adulterating our whole understanding of customary international law. As Baker continues, the reinterpretation of customary international law advocated by the non-traditional scholarship is one which seeks to move the sources of customary international law away from their practice-based methodological orientation and instead employ methods which are completely normative in nature. Now, Maine's narrative and the conceptual tools which he provides allow us to escape the perplexity which new rules pose for our understanding of customary legal rules as such. Rather than a mere process of identification, declaration, and interpretation, we see a whole universe of changes taking place right in front of our eyes, even if we cannot properly comprehend them. The traditional process of customary international law formation, usually referred to as state practice and opinio iuris, exists and functions separately and parallel to the later developed processes of legal fictions and equity, which act as agents of change. In this way, In this way, Maine's philosophical perspective allows us to exhibit and comprehend better the current development, the current level of development of customary international law, and his scheme can accommodate both descriptive or practice-based and normative processes. Further, despite the lack of legislative means, customary international law is not reduced to the level of mere customary law, since the other two agents are not only normal processes in the evolution of law, but a clear sign of intricate development. Yeah? Okay. I'm going to stop here. But it says 13 and 50, so I had 1 minute more.
If you are more, then you are more.
Well, I only had one more slide.
No.
But
you
can read it.
Thank you. This is digital. This I have this whole thing on watch. I'm so sorry.
No problem.
Yeah, I allowed you, but you don't do it. So, yeah, one, two, yeah, okay, Panos.
Well, I'm going to use and abuse the rules, so I will ask you one question. Is formalism the best way, giving you the option to answer the last slide?
That's very ingenious. Yeah.
Well, I don't have an answer. I just wanted to highlight a direction of answers that we haven't yet considered. So while Maine never really evaluated the term to formalism, certain theories following in his directions did. So James Coolidge Carter, one of the founders of the New York Bar Association, successfully opposed the codification of the common law in New York. His argument was that insofar as common law remains customary, it implicitly changes through practice, always up to date with the society that it serves. A statute, on the other hand, or a codification, on the other hand, is a statute frozen in time in a particular level of development. This detaches both the rule from the practices that underpin them, but also require formal legislative means for the adoption of law. Which brings us to the last figure, which is Friedrich Hayek, because he scrutinized the idea of legislative interventions. His argument was that grown orders intertwined with society in such a complicated manner that individuals cannot understand. As such, by allowing legislative means, we might break the cohesiveness that law has with society, detaching it completely, and at the same time inhibiting the process of grown norms, which might be more capable of serving society. So I just wanted to mention these two point of views, because it seems that we take formalism as not only the ideal, but the standard, and we kind of forget that there are other possibilities. Maybe customary international law presents us with new possibilities that we shouldn't be so fast in dismissing, and we shouldn't be so fast in tampering with international law's customary nature.